we are looking at the causes of power loss in a motor vehicle, and specifically today we are looking at the turbo charger unit. The turbo charger is one of the components of the motor vehicle that most of the people hear about, but they actually don't know how they function. Maybe to give you a bit of history about turbo chargers, the word turbo charger came in just recently, but in the early development of motor vehicles, they were not called turbo chargers, they are called super chargers. And sometimes we have a name called the roots type of blower or roots blower. And the purpose of these was to blow air into the engine to maximize what we call engine volumetric efficiency. And engine volumetric efficiency means the amount of air that is induced into the engine under a pump pressure. I just remember that in the original versions of chargers, these chargers were using engine power to run. For example, they could be run by a gear or they could be run by an engine belt. So you have a pump at the same time controlled by the engine itself. And during that time, these kinds of blowers and also chargers were consuming a lot of engine power. So later on, when technology kept on revolving, the manufacturers discovered that if they take advantage of the escaping exhaust gases and then they tap the power from those gases, the energy, then that energy would run a turbine, and that turbine would run an impeller, and then that impeller then would suck in air and also pump air into the vehicle system. Hence the term turbo chargers. The reason why they are called turbo chargers is because they are run by the escaping exhaust gases. Remember that the escaping exhaust gases don't cost on fuel, don't cost anything. Unlike, you know, the roots type of blowers or the superchargers, which were run by the engine power. And so this one had a lot of impact on the fuel of the engine as well as on the power of the engine. So the superchargers, when technology went on advancing, the superchargers went out of construction, and then there was introduced what we call turbo chargers. And in today's world and today's motor industry, turbo chargers are very common on vehicles. One of the advantages of these turbo chargers is that you can have a very small engine but produce a power of a greater magnitude, which is not synonymous to small engines. So I'll give you an example. If you have an engine which is about 2,000 cubic centimeters cc without turbocharged, okay, you can also have another engine which is about 1,500 cc turbocharged, and the 1,500 cc turbocharged will produce power equivalent to a 2,500 or 2,000 cc engine which is not turbocharged or supercharged. So you can see the advantages of superchargers or turbochargers. Now the question comes in that how do superchargers or how do turbochargers affect the performance of the power of the engine? First and foremost, we need to discover and understand the dynamics of how the engine combustion process works. As you know that you drive your vehicle to a fuel station and then you have fuel injected, or you have fuel put into your tank, and then later this fuel, which is a chemical energy, will later go under a combustion process when mixed with air into the engine. Remember, the traditional vehicles, for example, like, you know, carburetor engines as well as the traditional diesel engines. In carburetor engines, you used to have a mixture of air and fuel go into the cylinder at once. But when technology kept on advancing, you now have, especially when it comes to electronic fuel ignition systems, you have the VVTI systems, etc. You have the engine inducing air. Now, when it comes into a turbocharged engine, you have a charger or a fan or an impeller driven by a turbine which pumps air into the cylinder and enhances the magnitude of air. So you have a lot of air which is ready to undergo a combustion, you know, process. So what happens is, when considering superchargers or when considering turbochargers, is that they charge or they improve the amount and the volume of air in the system all in the engine, which we technicians call volumetric efficiency. And once that one has been achieved, you inject in fuel, and if it is a diesel engine, you inject in fuel all the fuel ignition systems that are electronic, petrol and diesel. The fuel is injected into the cylinders, and once the fuel is injected, then you have ignition take place, and then after ignition take place, then you have a power phase, and that power phase will culminate into the running of the engine. Now, the turbocharger, once the turbocharger has a problem, then you are not going to have the cylinders charged up to the right volume of air. And so in the process, once you have combustion take place, you're going to have the engine perform weaker. And once you put it on road and you're driving the vehicle, you will discover that the vehicle is not pulling, especially when it comes to areas where the driver needs speed. The vehicle will not be speeding up. The vehicle will not be climbing on hills just because it has less air, which has been absorbed by the engine because of the faulty, you know, turbocharger unit. So the turbocharger plays a very important role in the, you know, the development of the power and the horsepower of the engine, because remember that when you took off engine compression, you are compressing a lot of air, and that a lot of air, once it has been ignited with the fuel, will give a very big impact of engine power, which will also culminate into engine speed. Welcome to our segment on signs and safety. And in these episodes, we are looking at causes of car fires, how they begin and how you can be able to eliminate and also prevent them from happening. There are very many people with experiences of almost getting burnt in their own cars. And what we are looking at today, we are looking at electrical circuits and connections, short circuits. What we mean by a short circuit is when one of the, you know, wires or electrical connection is short circuiting and is creating heat or is sparking. Of course, when you look at the vehicle itself, it has got two charges. The first one is the positive charge, and the next one is the negative charge. Of course, just like any other ordinary, you know, for example, domestic electrical wiring, so is almost close to the wiring of the car. But the difference is that in the electrical household wiring, you are using alternative current, and in the motor vehicle, you are using direct current. And you know, direct current does not shock, it does not kill. It's very different from alternative current. So the direct current can be manageable, but can also be destructive, especially if you have got what you call short circuits. If the positive wiring finds connection with the negative wiring, then you are going to have a fire start right there. So one of the ways under which some car fires start is they start because there is a short circuit in the electrical system. That short circuit can be caused by mechanical error, can be caused by, you know, loose and also broken wires that have, you know, charge or power on them. Some of those broken wires, the wires can break just because maybe you have rats and, you know, and insects that eat up the wires, and then they allow them to stay exposed. For example, you can have, I've seen circumstances where, and scenarios where a rat has, you know, eaten wires. The rat eats the positive and the negative wire, which is related, which is next to it. And with the time, as you keep driving, you have those two, you know, insulators eaten up, and then you have a fire spark right there. So in such cases, it might be very difficult to exactly know where the fire has started from. But one of the ways this fire can be prevented is to do a regular inspection on your wiring system, especially if you are a kind of person who is visited more by rats and insects in your vehicles, or you're a kind of person whose car might be so old that it has to be worked on its electrical system most of the time. So it's very important to do an inspection on the wiring system of your car to make sure that you don't have a wire or, you know, a connection that's going to lead a problem, lead a problem to you of your car, you know, catching fire. Secondly, there are some, you know, loose connections and also loose harnesses. Sometimes these loose harnesses, as they keep, you know, moving within each other, create a problem. They create heat, they create sparks, and then you have a fire start right there. Sometimes it may not be able, you may not be able to tell that the car fire has been started by electrical, you know, circuit. But one of the things that you must know is that once you have any car fire that is taking place, the first thing that you should ever do is to open your bonnet and remove a battery terminal. That's what you have to do. You open the bonnet and remove the battery terminal. And once you remove the battery terminal, you have, you know, eliminated further damage that is caused by, you know, the short circuit. The vehicle system has got fuses, but sometimes the fuses may not really help, especially when the car is old. But one of the primary, you know, purposes of the fuse is to blow once it senses any short circuit. But in case the fuse has not blown, then you have the short circuit escalate. So it's very important to make sure that you check your wiring system. Even if you are not a technician, but glancing, you can be able to see what is wrong and ask the technician to sort it out. Remember, prevention is better than cure.